Lithium-ion batteries are incredibly appealing for EV applications because they can pack a lot of energy into a small and light package. But for stationary storage, the size and weight don't really matter. What does matter is cost, especially when you need longer storage durations of 10 hours and more. To double the storage duration of a lithium-ion battery, you pretty much need to double the cost. But that's not the case for flow batteries, which is the topic of today's video. Flow batteries are a type of rechargeable battery that uses two chemical components dissolved in liquid electrolyte. The electrolyte is stored in external tanks and pumped through a reaction chamber to produce electricity. Last year, while I was in Brisbane, I had a chance to tour a hybrid flow battery manufacturer, RedFlow. In this video, we're going to look at how their batteries work, how they're tested, and how their design has evolved over the years. I'm Rosie Barnes. Welcome to Engineering with Rosie. I was keen to visit RedFlow because while the hype around flow batteries is a pretty recent thing, these guys are no spring chickens. They kicked off pilot studies back in 2010, and by now there are RedFlow batteries in over 250 sites. Originally, they were just selling single 10 kilowatt hour batteries for residential and remote sites, for example, for communications. But these days, they're looking at large modular systems in the tens to hundreds of megawatt hours. So first, let's just quickly look at how a RedFlow battery works. Then we'll start the tour, and some of the RedFlow staff will explain each component in detail. To charge the battery, electrolyte is pumped through two half cells in the battery stack. In one half cell, zinc ions gain electrons and become metallic zinc, which collects on the electrode. In the other half cell, bromide loses an electron and becomes complex bromide, which deposits on the other electrode. The first half of the process uses electricity to power the pumps, and then to get that electricity back, the reactions run in reverse and electrons are released to provide an electric current. So that all sounds very simple, and I mean it is. It's a simple pair of reactions using pretty common, cheap, and safe chemicals. The reaction is nearly identical to a lemon battery if you ever happen to make one of those when you're a kid. But like with many of the technologies that I cover on this channel, though the science is appealingly simple, the tricky part, and the really cool part in my opinion, is the engineering. Because setting up that reaction pair in a couple of beakers or, you know, a couple of lemons would not make a cheap, reliable, efficient, compact battery. So the actual RedFlow battery is a bit more complex. Let's take a closer look at each component, starting with the cell stacks, which consist of layers of electrodes and separators through which the electrolyte flows. Chloe and Nelson, one of RedFlow's research scientists, is going to show those to us and explain.
This is one of the electrodes, big beaker, the zinc surface and the bromine surface. The channels is where our electrolyte flows. So we have the electrolyte coming from the pump, and after it flows uniformly all over the electrodes. Between the electrodes we have what we call the separator. It's a polymeric microporous membrane, and it helps keeping some of the species we have in the battery away from our zinc electrodes, because they can cause self-discharge of the battery. So the electrolyte looks different depending on the charging state of the battery.
It's got some zinc and some
bromine, because they are the main elements for the electrochemical reactions that we want to happen.
The one on the left is how it starts out.
The one on the left is a higher state of charge of the battery. So as we produce bromine, the organic molecule we have in the electrolyte captures the bromine, and it settles down because it has higher density than the water.
That's the guts of the battery where all the reactions are happening. In addition to that, there's just some plastic tanks to hold the electrolyte and electric pumps to move the electrolyte through the cell stack. So some of you are likely familiar with the concept of a flow battery, and you might be thinking, this RedFlow battery is a bit unusual. And you're right, it's a hybrid flow battery, not a pure flow battery. The basic difference is that in a pure flow battery, the reactions take place in the electrolyte at the electrodes and the ions remain in the electrolyte suspension. Whereas the RedFlow battery stores energy in the physical plating of zinc out of the electrolyte solution onto the anode and then releases the energy when the zinc is returned to the electrolyte. The consequence of this is that a pure flow battery's energy and power can be completely separated. Longer storage duration simply comes from larger tanks. On the other hand, in a RedFlow battery, energy is stored in the zinc plating on the anode. So to get longer storage duration, you need more surface area on your anode. But the upside is that the total space taken up is smaller in RedFlow batteries than pure flow batteries, about half that of other flow battery chemistries with the same energy. The efficiency of the two is similar, around 70 to 80%, and that's in the same ballpark as other long-duration energy storage options like pumped hydro or compressed air. So that's the main components and how the battery works. Now let's move on to some of the practicalities. One of the most interesting aspects of RedFlow is that they have a lot of real-world operation experience. Some of their batteries have been running for 8 years with up to 2,000 full depth charge and discharge cycles. The reason that's interesting to me is that we're able to see the iterative nature of this kind of technology development. A lot of these kinds of videos will show technologies at the lab scale where it's all excitement and possibilities. But to make it off the lab bench and into the real world at a scale that can make a difference, technologies need to get cheap and reliable. And the way they do that is through learning cycles. Design, test, learn from your failures, and then repeat that as rapidly as possible. So let's take a look at the research and development that RedFlow are doing. Conan Jones, RedFlow's product manager, is going to show us the various tests that they've got running and what design changes they've made based on their experience from their installed systems over the years. And this is your long duration battery?
This is our long duration battery testing. The battery on the right is our newest generation 3 battery, the ZBM3. And the battery over there is the ZBM2.5. It ramps it up and down through different charge and discharge profiles, looks for depth of discharge, takes it all the way down to zero, takes it all the way up to 100, runs it through linear and non-linear testing profiles as well, as they will be tested in the real world. So this is where we're doing some more real world testing. The long duration testing in the lab we're doing at 48 volts, yep, which is the native voltage of the battery. Here we're actually connecting the batteries to inverters. So we actually are creating AC electricity out of them, and we're running them through different types of loads.
RedFlow have had some of their batteries out in the wild for years now, with some at the end of their lifetimes already or needing to be replaced for other reasons. So what are they doing with the batteries they receive back? Is it possible to reuse and eventually recycle them?
We have a complete recyclability path and plan for the entire battery. No heavy metals, yeah, No leads, no toxic chemicals, nothing that will break down into a toxic chemical. We still receive batteries back that are then disassembled and analyzed, either in the different labs that we've got or in the test facilities. And then we repurpose them. So we get separate stacks and we restack a battery. So we increase the longevity of the battery.
I love doing these in-person tours because you get a much better sense of the technology by seeing it up close and touching it where possible. So let's take a look at some of these batteries now to get a sense for their size.
This housing is what we're going to call our quad pod, and it will hold 4 ZBM3 batteries, which will give us energy storage of 40 kilowatt hours. Each battery will be able to deliver continuously at 3 kilowatts, which means that from a power rating, we could deliver 12 kilowatts, 40 kilowatt hours.
So to put it in terms that everyone understands, everyone knows the Tesla Powerwall is 12 kilowatt hours, I think.
A little bit deeper, but then you never discharge a Tesla
completely. Okay, it's got 12 usable
I think it's 13.4.
Okay, and what did you say this one was?
This will be 40.
40, okay. So it's bigger than 4 power walls.
This would be roughly equivalent to 3 or 4 power walls.
And what applications are you expecting this for? I mean, it's not going to fit in someone's garage.
No, it's not intended for residential. Yeah. It's possibly intended for very high-end residential. Somebody who has a large estate, who might have a house, a workshop, a games room, yeah, a pool room, a heated pool, somebody who's got a lot of solar that they want to absorb during the day and use at night. So this was a 16 battery module, which was called the Pod Z. It's recently been renamed the Pod 160 because it's 160 kilowatt hours of storage.
So you got four. Okay, so 16.
So this is our Pod 160. But we will probably not produce the Pod 160 again because it had to fit a pre-existing site. But it has led us to develop what we will be bringing to market in the next couple of months, called our Pod 200. Yeah. And then instead of the power conversion system in a cabinet, the last little bit of space is a wider cabinet, because then we can do a row of 20 circuit breakers for the 20 batteries coming in. And that will be our modular version going forward.
Well, that was really cool to get to see RedFlow's facilities and learn about how the batteries work and their development process. It's been most of a year since I did that tour, and in the meantime, they're moving on to bigger and bigger projects, the latest being a 2 megawatt hour installation in California that was completed in December last year. I know they've got plans to go even bigger, and I'm really looking forward to this next phase of the energy transition, where we start to actually build a lot of long-duration energy storage instead of just talking about it a lot like we have been for the last few years. Thanks heaps to RedFlow for the tour and their patience while I took months and months to complete this video. If you want to help me speed up the rate that I put out new videos whilst keeping the quality high and get a say in which topics you think I should cover next, then you can join the Engineering with Rosie Patreon team at this link. And thanks to you for watching. I'll see you in the next video.